Howdy, folks. I'm back. I'm standing on a chair, the chair I sit on at my workbench, and this is the bracing for the Oscar Schmidt guitar. I'm going to turn this back off and do a little more stuff. There's the bracing, but it is not yet scalloped. If I brace it the way it's shown right now, the top will be too rigid. Experience has shown me that. The bridge plate has not been made yet. I'll do the bridge plate after I've glued these in place. Okay, bye. Howdy. We're back. I just took a picture of the bracing and I did a video of the bracing looking from overhead. We're going to scallop it, each brace, before we build it. This plan is from Stuart McDonald. It's like 25 years old. I've used it a number of times, as you can see. Blueprints fade, so I've gone through with pencil and increased the outline again. So, my bracing has fewer parts. It's a smaller system. I saved the braces from all the old guitars I work on, and I had enough to use even for the X bracing on this. And what I'm going to do is take each brace and look at its equivalent brace. Here you can see this is a smaller guitar. I've braced the area, I've marked the areas that are going to remain high, and I'll use this here machine. This is a belt sander that I have specially modified to be quiet and smooth. And I'll use the rounded edge here to help me scallop it. Beginning to scallop it all, clean a little more up off of these edges. The rest have been cleaned up, and when these are all scalloped, we'll come back and look at them being glued into place. We're back. Each brace has been scalloped. There are works of art, works of ed. And basically, regular old tight bond. We're going to glue the braces in. They're laid out here in the manner that they will go back in. And we'll come back short a mente. Yep. Here you have the force modules. I start with these. I use these go bars. These go up to the ceiling and they bend and push down on strategic locations. And I had the bracing held in place with those, but we still have some top warpage that I'm trying to get rid of. And so I've taken those out, put them where these won't work, and then these are critically placed to be on top of whatever brace I can find. No, I spend time trying to get these things actually to push down on the braces, and if they span two braces, I want them to be equally pushing down. Anyway, I've spent some time cleaning up glue and We're gonna wait till tomorrow morning and see what we have. That should end the top, except for filling in a few places where there are cracks, and then we move on to the neck. We may glue the back on before I fret the neck. Who knows? Well, this is the resulting bracing pattern. The braces are installed and they're also scalloped. So I managed to flatten the top. There was a slight dip in the top that I finally removed when I used the graviton force module system, pressing down on all this, which we saw in the last video. So, next, there's a you're not going to be able to see this, but you never can tell. The lighting is bad. There's a hump right here where the neck meets the body. It's common. I'm going to pull all the frets and level this. Recut the grooves if I need to. Excuse me. Recut the grooves if I need to. And also, excuse me, start looking at the final angle of the neck. This will be a cursory check. And right now, we're very close. And if I push on this at all, we're right where we need to be. So when I put the back on the guitar, this will have a slight preload to give it its final angle adjust. The top goes on and maintains whatever this distortion is. So I'm going to pull the frets, level the fretboard, and I also need inside here the bridge plate. I'll make a bridge plate out of maple to fill this space, and oak is a little too rigid. Make it out of oak, it'll be a little thinner, it'll probably be maple. Okay. We're going to catch a little of this because it's so exciting. This will continue until it's all this color. It'll be checked with a straight edge and a feeler gauge until it's level within 2 or 3 thousandths of an inch. It's not a regular belt sander. It's friendly. I'm able to speak and you can hear me. It's running at half the speed that it was designed to run at, which is half the speed of the ones you can buy today. The ones you can get today are direct drive. They run at 3,600 RPM. You put a piece of wood on there, it disappears. This, I waited 2 years till I found one with a pulley system. I got a small pulley on the motor, the biggest pulley I can get here without belt rubbing. It's running very slowly, and it works really well. We're back. I've leveled this to plus or minus 2,000s, and now I'm going to make sure these grooves are not only deep enough, but wide enough. I've evolved my own method of fretting guitars over the past 50 years, and it involves using a fairly wide slot that I can press these into with only hand force, minimal force, which allows me to keep track of their levelness. They're held in either with tight bond or crazy glue. These days it's going to be crazy glue. In some cases, like here, this has been sanded more than this. These will have to be deepened significantly. If there's a big bow in the neck, these will also have to be deepened significantly. Right here, you can see we didn't even quite get down, but it's still level, and some final sanding will get a little more of the white. Because it is white, now that I think about it, it's an ideal candidate for that black-white fretboard thing, so these will have to be lightened up. And that will happen. Let's do a little... what I'll do is go back to the belt sander after this, and it'll help remove any little discontinuities that may arise. So what I'm doing here is, by eye, I pretty much know how deep it could be. I could mark the blade if I wished. I've also, by feel, and angling the thing a little bit, just making sure that the fret can go down in there. I don't want this any deeper than it has to be, because it'll weaken the overall strength of the fretboard. So why don't I mark this saw? Because I'm an artiste. So this is going to continue. Not much to this. I have a few other blades. These are hobby hacksaw blades from Ace Hardware. They'd be a good sponsor. And you can get them probably with a little different teeth count and kerf. Plus there are going to be knockoff brands that will be different. So you can have a collection of these blades. Anyway. That's what I'm going to do. When I get to here, I have to take a blade and hold it in my hand. I should stop and make a fixture to hold the blade. I may do that too. Thank you. I'm finishing up. These are the ones where I have to hold the blade, and I've done a few. This is the stuff I try to leave for the elves. I have a, there's a couple of elves here. That way, if I leave one of these out, and a couple of Coronas, come back in the morning, the whole thing's been fretted. The whole thing's been done. It's occurring to me these elves are don't have any papers. So they're happy to just, you know, I don't really know where they stay. Maybe these old shipping boxes. One of the reasons I buy guitars on Reverb is that I sell guitars on Reverb and I need shipping boxes. So every time I sell a guitar, I have to buy another guitar so as to get the box that it'll end up being shipped out with. Anyway, rather than wait for the elves, I may do the fretting process next. A couple of things. These are Stuart McDonald medium frets. If you're a finger picker, you need a minimum fret height of about 0.35, and 0.40 is better. You get an older guitar, especially the harmonies with the skinny frets, they womped on them with a flat file before they left the factory. When they start to get low, they're much harder to get a very clear note out of. They're not able to be pressed down here enough to make good contact with the fret top. So if I'm going to be finger picking a guitar, 90% of the time, if I'm going to keep it, it's going to get refretted. This thing needed to be refretted anyway. So my other thing with whether to do the alternating colors, black and natural, are that there's a natural knot in the wood right here, and it's a discontinuity that will show. It's already got its own stock pearl dots. They're like plastic, the original plastic pearl dots. Anyway, I may just go black. I'll talk to the owner, but most likely he's getting a deal, and this would be part of what would allow me to do this guitar for less than $400. Okay. So, we're going to start to refret the guitar. This is a Stuart McDonald medium, buy it by the pound. I bought one of these, lasted 20 years. I used most of it in the last 2 years. And I'll use that up before you know it. Gotta watch out for discontinuities on the end. These get cut a little long. If I could just snip it right there, great, but I can't. There's lots of ways to do this. I could mark it with a magic marker, but I'm in production here. The next thing that'll happen is these will get trimmed. Also, this gets easier once we get out here away from the body. For production, I can use the belt sander to remove excess length of these frets if needed. Here we go. So this should be a little easier. You can put it in the groove even. As you can see, when you do your first few fret jobs, it takes most of a day, and after you do 50 or 60 of them, you just march through it. There's no mystery. You just have to be absolutely precise. No, there's ways of catching each of these. It's a matter of what's the most efficient way. Well, you can see we're nearly done with this. And it's early enough at night to use the belt sander, but I will probably use the file on the ones that don't need a lot of removal. Okay, let's just let's take these, put them in order. One, two. Okay, here's the first easy fret. Ace Hardware. So basically, I'm doing a lot of things here. I'm getting the light length, I'm beginning to round the edge of the fret, and I'm mostly going to file away a major portion of the tang because it got bent when it got cut. Now, it's the attention to detail. Detail. It's almost perfectly linked. Again, the final length can be trimmed after the frets are installed, but so you're watching the process for one fret. And it's sticking out a little bit. That's okay. I continue this process. As you can see, if you don't fool around a lot, this goes along fairly rapidly. And we won't be watching the entire process. Usually this happens only on one end because of the nature of the cutters themselves. They make a clean cut on one side and displace on the other. So each cut produces one each of those. Perfect. Getting lucky here. Anyway, this process will continue. They pretty much are snapped in, but they're not totally snapped in. That'll happen just before I say go. Anyway, we're going to do that to all these frets. These, I may use a belt sander to remove, but I'll probably just file them too. So, when they've all been trimmed to size, I'll show them being snapped into place. I don't know what that is. Anyway, moving right along. Well, the frets are in. They're level to plus or minus 2,000ths easily, probably more level than that. They need to be finally completely leveled and recrowned. I'm going to zoom in here to the part of the fretboard. This is the seventh fret. There's a, we're not focusing that well. I don't know what to do about that. There's a knot in the wood. So, again, the owner of the guitar has gone with black for the body. It'll look good with that trim. It's real binding. We're going to go black and white motif on the fretboard, but that part there is going to be antiqued, to say the least. Here we have also sketched in the pyramid bridge. The pyramid bridge is just sitting on there, but It's becoming reborn.